listening to all those kind remarks, I don't really don't know where to begin. But anyway, I want to thank Master of Ceremonies, Representative Gary Locke. I welcome Archbishop Thomas Murphy here, Archbishop Cornelius Power, Father Gerard Stanley, of course, all the speakers at the head tables, Speaker Brian Ebersole, who's really a master at understanding people and has a great feeling towards individuals. He's, for the last period of time since he's been in the legislature, he's been a great personal friend of mine. Time after time, he's used his speech to nominate me on the floor of the House. I'm messing up a little bit today. But anyway, he's going to be a great speaker because he has a feeling for people, he understands, he's got good judgment. Of course, Governor and Mrs. Dan Evans, I'm very proud to have them here, along with Governor and Mrs. Albert Mosley. Both governors and I had great relationships. It's true that Governor Evans, when he was a member of floor leader in the House of Representatives, one night got terribly upset. And really got upset about Governor Mosley's bill. And was waving and telling me what an awful bill it was and things of that nature. And so it's true, I said, Representative Evans, if you don't stop, I'm going to have you ejected from the chambers. So I said, I think you better go over and sit down. So he did, but anyway. Governor Evans and I were great friends. Many occasions when he was a member of the House of Representatives, we worked rather closely together and he seemed to be always in my corner. And it's true that Governor Rosalini one time did veto his salary increase. The legislators saw so kindly to offer increases to all elected officials. So Governor Rosalini being a true politician and understanding the whims people instead of Washington decided it'd be good public policy if he vetoed his salary increase. So shortly thereafter, we went back into session. He said, John, you can override my veto, aren't you? So I had to process override the governor's veto, so you get a salary increase. But anyway, that's a part of the business of being a legislator. Something that I probably enjoyed tremendously. I want to thank Maria Campbell for being here. And it's true that she did the Irish thing for me in my office. She was a great legislator and great understanding. Of course, it helped my relationship with her because she's Irish. And she always told me about her Irish background. And Lou and Diane Tice are great personal friends of mine. Power of having goals to achieve things and his understanding of people. He's a great speaker. He's well trained, so is Diane. It's something that I cherish their friendship because they have great understandings. I deeply appreciate all the legislators that came here tonight and those that served with me, some that served with me in the past. They're all great public spirited citizens. I'm also very thankful for the people of the district that came. Many presidents, past presidents of the Rainier Chamber of Commerce, President Norm Chamberlain is here, and many others have worked so closely with me for many years in the Rainier District. And many friends and neighbors came to my mind. I want to thank all of them for coming. So I deeply appreciate all the kind remarks that were said. And the committee charge arrangements, headed by Gary Locke, Bill Dunbar, Marion, John Charles, Stanley Knott, Katie Pickering, members of my family, Lori, Jeannie, Karen, Marianne, Paul, and my sister-in-law, Florence Hosterman, John Sullivan, who played so well for us. So I've had a great privilege serving for many years. Over those period of time, I have everlasting memories of some of the great issues and events and resolutions which were adopted during that span of time. I certainly also appreciate the fact that so many members of the clergy are here, Father Ryan, Father Sullivan, the sisters, Sister Marie, Rosemary, Parish, Sister Mary Tracy, Sister Seal, Garvin, Sister Moffat. I appreciate it, Brother Lindman. I appreciate the fact that you came to join with us on this occasion. Most of all, it was a great pleasure I had of serving with some of the finest people in the state of Washington. This friendship I will always cherish. It just seems that we developed a bond of camaraderie and friendship and understanding. During legislative session, we do have many trials and tribulations, some very hard decisions to make. It's something that you develop an inner feeling that lasts my experience in my life and my feeling forever. And so it's been a great pleasure for me to have all of you here tonight. And I value deeply all of your friendships because you're great friends, you're part of our family. And I know when I speak for my wife and myself that we're very happy that you came. I might say the most rewarding experience of any legislator I've found is never too soon to render a kindness to someone who needs assistance, sponsor a bill to alleviate a problem, or to clarify an issue, to be willing at all times to compromise to accomplish an objective. Again, on behalf of my wife and family, thank you very much for coming. I deeply appreciate your presence. In closing, I would like to recite this Irish proverb. May the road always rise to meet you. May the wind always be at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face, the rain fall soft upon your fields. Until we meet again, may God hold you in the palm of his hand. Thank you very much.
Sponsors and contributors to this program to make this event and tribute possible. particularly PEMCO, as I mentioned earlier, which underwrote and handled many of the expenses and the printing and the arrangements for this evening's event, along with ARCO, a major contributor and sponsor of this event, but many, many others that are listed on your program on the last page, along with the additions that are listed in the insert tonight's program. John, you have touched many people's lives. You bring tonight from throughout the state, from all political parties, people who have worked with you, that you've tutored and have inspired. But more than that, because there are so many more people here than the politicians, past and present, are your friends and your constituents. People who represent the issues that you've worked on, people who you've touched in your many, many years of public service. Many of us elected officials seek the hot political issue. Many of us work on landmark legislation. You, I have noticed, tend to the basics of government, taking care of your constituents and the needs and concerns of the people. From the person who hasn't received a Social Security check, a person who is having trouble obtaining child support, a person who is having trouble with the bureaucracy. That has been the hallmark of you, Mr. Speaker, tending to the people of your district and your state. John O'Brien has mentioned in the article that I referred to in the first few pages of your program, stood for public power, stood when public power and private power, the private utilities, were in a battle. And Speaker O'Brien used his influence, his power as the Speaker of the House, to cut off the debate so that public power, our public utilities, would continue to be strong in our state. As a result of that action, knowing that it could cost him politically, he did that. And in fact, the following year, those who opposed him, who disagreed with him, did not vote to let him continue as Speaker of the House of Representatives. In taking that action, he put principle above his political future. And that's the type of man that John O'Brien is, the person who put the needs of our state and our people first, regardless of the political consequences. It's been my pleasure to have worked with you in my 10 years, over the last 10 years. You sitting in front of me and Gene Lux sitting next to me giving me conflicting advice. It was great fun, not knowing how to go. A socialist on the one hand and a mainstream Catholic on the other hand. I was getting weird, so I had to finally move. But I have most appreciated your tutelage, your kindness, your wisdom, and that's why we're all here tonight. To pay you our respects, to give you our thanks for serving the people of the state of Washington. Thank you so very much, John and Mary O'Brien.
Mary Locke, to this short shot, our sign of appreciation for the fun job he's done here tonight. Mary, thank you.
The hour is late, the program is concluded, and now with the benediction, Archbishop Thomas Murphy.
I know New John's power extended to other parts of the state, but I was in Shelton earlier tonight. He was the only one possibly who could get me out of a dinner in Shelton. So thank you, John. Let us pray. People come together for various reasons, in and out of different seasons, but tonight people from Evans to Ryan have come to honor John O'Brien. We've all had a bite to eat and even a drink to help us pause and stop and think about all that one man has said and done on behalf of you and me and everyone. Our toasts tonight have been hale and hearty for a hero of the Democratic Party. But we know John's success would have been scary without the support and love of a wife named Mary. John has shown that when it comes to age, he has only grown far more sage. And we give thanks for this man of the people whose voice is heard on streets and steeple. But before we close the political door, who knows, John might run in 94. But tonight we end with a fervent prayer that God might bless a man just and fair, with gifts more important than power or wealth, but rather gifts of grace and peace, life and health. So thank you, John, for the gift you've been to countless families and children, women and men. And again, from all, from Evans to Ryan, may God bless you, John L. O'Brien. Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much and have a safe journey home.
Thank you. throw at it. All my hats.
Thank you. Well,